Hello, and finally, welcome back for the next video in my Beginner's Thoughts series. It's been a long time since I've made one of these videos, but I just didn't feel ready to make this one. Then, when I was about to record, something else happened, which you'll want to stick around for. I am still quite new to this hobby, and I am continuously learning new things as I observe the life within the glass box. This video is not going to be an in-depth care guide, but a short look at my beginner's thoughts and experiences and answer some of those initial questions I had about the pets I am keeping. Today, I will be looking at the Otocinclus catfish. I have kept otos for about 2 years now, and they are one of my absolute favorite fish. They are small, friendly, and I love watching them wiggle around as they swim. One of the reasons that it has taken me this long to make this video is there isn't much actually known about otos. There are 22 different known species of Otocinclus, 17 of which are kept in the hobby. It can be quite tricky to know which species of otto that you have, as a lot of them look very similar, but they all have similar care requirements. At first, I just assumed, since all my fish were purchased from the same store, they must be the same fish. Turns out, I actually have two different species of otos in my tank. It's quite common for mixed species to be sold under a common name, with a lot of stores not even specifying species. Pretty much all Otocinclus, with a few exceptions, have a mottled gray-brown top half, a white belly, and dark stripe running from nose to tail. The fins are usually translucent. Their eyes are on the sides of their head, which gives them good vision in almost all directions. They are also interesting in the way that they have a more of an armored plating instead of scales, similar to a pleco and some other catfish. Something else that kind of surprised me was the first time I saw an otto dart to the surface and breathe air. They don't do it very often, and when they do, they're extremely quick. A full-grown otto will be about 2.5 to 5.5 centimeters in length, and in my experience, most seem to be close to full-grown already when purchasing them. My smallest measures 2.4 centimeters, and my largest is about 4.2. I won't be going over all the differences for each species, but I will show how I identified which species I have. Four of my fish are ovestitis. These otos have dark mottled gray backs, which meet right at the black stripe, not really split by white. The stripe also extends all the way through the tail with two defined vertical bars. My other three fish are O. macrospilus. These are slightly larger, and while they are the same color, the patterns are a little different. The mottled top half isn't usually connected to the black stripe, having a thin white section between. The black stripe also fades out right before the marking on the tail, which is a less defined blotch shape. It can be difficult to tell which Otocinclus species you have, as there is a lot of confusion, mix-ups, and mislabeled pictures on the internet. I would recommend checking out Planet Catfish for the most reliable information on Otocinclus catfish, and r/Otocinclus has been helpful as well. I find there are a lot of people that buy otos as a cleaner fish, just to get rid of some algae. My otos were purchased not as cleaners, but as pets. I will go into this a little bit more later. Ever since I found out about Otocinclus, I've always heard that they're pretty difficult to keep. Fortunately, I've had success with all of my otos so far. I've had no initial losses, and only had one otto pass after 2 years, which I believe was most likely due to age. Otocinclus aren't actually that difficult to care for. The reason for a lot of the initial loss usually comes down to the fact that otos are wild-caught. Once the fish has finally made it to your house, it could have been weeks or even a month or more since the fish was in its natural habitat with food. If starvation starts, it's unfortunately near impossible to bring them back from it. Otos also need to adapt to eating foods that they aren't used to. There's no algae wafers or blanched veggies in the wild. To help avoid the initial loss, the best thing to do is to add otos to a mature, seasoned setup. This will ensure there is more biofilm and microfauna that the otos can eat while you introduce them to their new diet. The other way I've seen otos pass is when they're purchased to clean a tank, but when the job's done, they're not supplemented with other foods. They just eat by cleaning up all the unsightly algae and fish poop, right? In the wild, Otocinclus eat something called ofwuks. Simply put, it's a mix of small microscopic animals and plants that adhere to the surfaces like leaves and rocks underwater. In the home aquarium, it's best to give Otocinclus a varied diet. Algae wafers or similar algae fish food can be offered, and most otos will happily eat it, but you should also offer vegetables to them as well. Blanched veggies are a good way to feed otos and get them some nutrients. I've tried lettuce, kale, cucumber, and zucchini. Blanched zucchini seems to be a favorite. Just remember to remove uneaten food after a few hours, or it could affect your water quality. Most of the time, otters will just sit on leaves or glass, grazing on any type of soft algae they may find. This does not mean they will eat all algae, though. I have learned that Otocinclus will not eat red algaes, such as blackbeard or staghorn algaes. They will also not eat green spot algae, that dark green stuff that's so difficult to get off your rocks and glass. These algaes are some that you will have to clean if they bother you. These fish are not just cleaners. Like any other fish, they still poop and contribute to the overall bioload of your aquarium and still need to be fed. Otocinclus catfish will greatly appreciate being in a planted tank. Driftwood is another good thing to have, as well as some smooth rocks. They also tend to like a bit more flow and movement in the water. I've also added catapa or Indian almond leaves, which will help promote the growth of biofilm, amongst other benefits. Another tricky thing about otos is being able to tell their gender. Males and females have the same coloration and marking. The easiest way to tell gender is to look at them from above. Females will be broader and usually slightly larger than males. Breeding these fish in the home aquarium is near impossible. While it has been done, it's an uncommon occurrence, and not much is understood about what triggers the spawning process. There are some good videos here on YouTube that successfully show breeding these fish and growing the fry, though it's still incredibly difficult. At the time of writing, one of my O. macrospilus is gravid, showing small yellow eggs when viewed from underneath. However, there's been no signs of spawning attempts at all. I will be keeping an eye on this, and will record an update if anything changes. I would love to be able to help with information about these fish so we can stop the need for so many wild-caught otos. And this is where I update! As I finished my script for this video and looked up on my tank, my otos were spawning! I will be making a video talking about my parameters and observations of the breeding process, so keep an eye out for that. Otocinclus, regardless of which species you have, are very friendly and peaceful fish with relatively easy care requirements. They make great additions to community tanks, shrimp tanks, or even just a species tank, which hopefully I'll be making in the near future. They are schooling fish and exist in thousands in the wild, so they should be kept in groups of six or larger to make them feel most comfortable. I originally only started with a single Otocinclus, but quickly got more. Seeing a group of them all wiggling along together is one of the most adorable things in my opinion. On a short side note, I have seen someone put an otto in the same tank as an Oscar cichlid. Please do not do this. Otters should only be kept with other smaller gentle fish. I personally love Otocinclus and think they are one of the cutest fish. While I generally would recommend keeping otos, I would only do so if you have a season tank and have done some research. Remember, these pets aren't choosing to live in your box, so we should try to give them the best home we can. If you stayed this far, did you know there were different species of otos? If you have any other tips for keeping healthy otos, please leave them down in the comments. Hopefully in the near future, we can learn to successfully and repeatedly breed these fish so they don't have to be stunned and wild caught. And this is where I auto end the video. Thanks for watching.